Are you looking for a podcast that talks about life, the universe, and everything? Listen in to the Illumination Hour, Monday nights, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific. Listen live at Spreaker.com or NonPartisanLibertyForall.com. We're also on SoundCloud, Spreaker, Twitter, Tumblr, YouTube, and iTunes. The Illumination Hour, brought to you by Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network, and your host, Ellen Stallone, because a spark can illuminate the world.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is September 7th, 2016, and I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote self-ownership and the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we, of course, are always happy to hear from you via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype at username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Which links to our Facebook and social media information, as well as all our contact information if you forget the number or the Skype username, as well as original articles or article slash blogs, as I like to call them, one being the series on the legalization of drugs and why they should go back to how they were as of 19 or before 1914, which is when they passed the actual first law that told you what you can put in your body, essentially. So what a difference 100 years makes. I wonder if anybody's actually well, I'm sure there's a couple of people that are alive from back then, but not that were conscious enough to go and buy heroin off the shelves. So tonight we have Ken Schortgen, who joins us every other Wednesday. The last time he was on, we did a special show and talked all about college football, which was fun. But tonight we're back to the economy and politics. And, of course, Ken has a new podcast, a new YouTube show slash podcast that you can get on YouTube, and he posts almost every day. Not every day, but I think about what, five shows a week there, Ken? Something like that?
Oh, I do. On my podcast, I do now Monday, Wednesday, Friday, but I make it known that I'm going to try to do three, but expect two. For example, last Friday, I got done with a pool tournament at like 1:30 in the morning, Thursday night, Friday morning. So I just didn't feel like doing one, Friday. But I did one on Labor Day, so sort of makes up for it.
So you can find those at Ken Schortgen. Just search the name and then subscribe to his channel there, which has been around for, what, about a month now? And it is doing pretty well. So you can get your every other day or three times a week reports on what's going on with the economy if you don't like reading articles. But if you'd rather read articles or do both, you can go to thedailyeconomist.com and read Ken's articles as well. So there, I wanted to mention something first that I meant to mention yesterday, but because I had an issue at the beginning of the show, I didn't get to it. I got a comment on, I have four Facebook pages, and one of them has all these views all the time, but nobody ever likes it. And I think it's because the name of it, and they're scared. It's about noncompliance and backed by self-defense. So that might scare some people off. But I did finally get a comment somehow from somebody who believes, and I won't read the whole thing, but of course, mentions that driving is a privilege. It had to do with the girl who ended up getting killed in the end. But at this point, she just got pulled over and didn't get out of her car. But that driving's a privilege, of course, and freedom to travel doesn't include motor vehicles, blah, blah, blah. But, of course, that the environment comes before any human privileges do. And check your privilege at the door. And then I actually looked at her page, and all I saw was stuff against the pipeline and shit like that. Obviously a big environmentalist. So how she ended up on my page that has like 13 likes compared to all my other ones that have at least, not that I have a lot compared to a lot of people. I mean, one has 4 something and the other ones I think are close to 200. It's not like, I have a huge following or anything, but this one only has 13, but I see people viewing it all the time, but it was weird to get that. But this bullshit that, the environment is more important than people. Now, I'm fine with, I want the environment as clean as possible, but of course, I'm not going to pay taxes on the air I breathe or exhale, or bullshit like that. They can increase my electric bill and pull more tax money. And things like, of course, bodies of water, I hope they're as clean as possible and the air is as clean as possible. But this, what I got from this person was that essentially the earth is more important than the people. And you get this from, like, the UN kind of has this thing kind of going that, the environment is more important, really, than the people, which they almost want to, well, it may not be an almost. It's a theory out there, but that, you should kill a bunch of people because they're ruining the environment and there's too many people, even though you could fit comfortably. I think it's either the whole United States or the whole world into the state of Texas comfortably. So obviously there's plenty of room. So that whole thing is a fallacy, especially with resources as well. They don't have, Obama was going around talking about, well, you people in Africa can't have electricity unless, we don't have the resources for everybody to have everything, and which is a bunch of bullshit. So it was weird to get a comment on here regarding, you know, from an environmentalist. I just love those people. Anyway, I know there are a lot of stories and things going on. One of the ones I wanted to bring up first that I thought was interesting, Ken, was the I called them the Pentagon versus the CIA wars, based on what you had said. Essentially, ISIS fighting, you know, the CIA fighting the military coming into the region.
Yeah, this was something a year and a half ago that statistician Dr. Jim Willey, for those who have heard him in his interviews or read the hat trick letter over at goldenjackass.com, he made the prediction about a year and a half ago that the morass that is in you know, the Middle East where ISIS is would come to an interesting clash, because, you know, those who were primarily the Syrian Free Army, all they were the terrorist groups like al-Nusra and al-Qaeda.
Right, and just sorry to interrupt, just a point, and that was, those were the ones that John McCain had went over there, remember, what was it, a couple of years ago, and was saying that the United States should arm those guys and all this shit, and he was, like, hanging out with them.
Exactly. And see, the thing about it is these guys were originally the quote-unquote Free Libyan Army, a bunch of ragtag, you know, militant groups that the CIA, the MI5 or MI6 and Mossad put together.
Well, they're paid anyway. I had even just to also mention, and I mentioned this before, that the ISIS fighters were paid, and there was you know, one of those shows that burrows in with the, you know, ISIS fighters or whatever. They were interviewing members of ISIS, and one of the guys was just like, you know, I'm doing this because I can't get another job and they pay more.
Well, yeah. And you know, the thing about it is those that come from Saudi Arabia, and they're not all from Saudi Arabia, but those who come from that area, Saudi Arabia is an oligarchy. It's got, you know, the 1% and it's got everybody else.
Right, right. It's got like a bunch of princes and stuff, right?
And see, that's mostly, yeah, that's mostly tied to their religious, the Wahhabism of Islam. Because if you take a look at like the United Arab Emirates or Qatar, they are not run necessarily by a monarchy, but they do have princes who are over those areas. But the government ensures that the people are well off. You know, that was the problem with Libya. I'll tell you what, you know, everybody remembers Gaddafi from the Ronald Reagan days.
Well, they never actually proved it, but they put the bombing on, they put that bombing of a plane. You might remember the flight, where it was going and what.
Yeah, it was going to Scotland.
And that was a Lockerbie bomber.
Yeah, that was it. It was Lockerbie, and okay. it was a Libyan national who was the bomber or the hijacker. And right.
And then they had bombed, after that, Reagan ordered the bombing of Gaddafi and they killed his daughter, but he had escaped, I think in 82 or something like that.
Yeah. And Gaddafi was then, he just pulled back and he was a good boy and he just dealt with, you know, dealing with his own country.
As far as you know, do that? Is there any information that you've heard that they just pinned that on him, or was, as far as you know, he was the one who was responsible for that?
No, Gaddafi was involved in terrorism along with Yasser Arafat in the 70s and 80s in Europe. So,
okay.
Yeah, he was a bad boy. As a matter of fact, Gaddafi was one of the leading proponents in the late 60s to create OPEC. So, you know, he's been in the mix for a long, long time. But the problem is that after he got beat down by Reagan.
Yeah, he totally changed later.
Exactly. And the thing about it is he loved his people. And because they got so much oil revenue, if you were a Libyan citizen, okay, when you got married, he gave you a house. And yeah, then he sent you off for a month to have a full vacation.
You had talked about that before.
Free education. I mean, just he wanted his people to be well off.
Well, you had also said that he was also planning on, sorry to cut you off, but in Africa as well, that you had mentioned some things about him planning to invest more in Africa, or he was in the process, that he was planning on doing some positive things.
Well, it's ironic you say that because, you know, before the show, I just finished an article. It's called The Final Screws Being Put on the Petrodollar System. And one of the examples I gave was, you know, with Libya. And here's the thing. It goes back to this actually came from one of Hillary's emails. Hint, hint. Here's how it goes. In spite of French-led UN Security Council Resolution 1973 creating a no-fly zone over Libya with the express intent of protecting civilians, one of the over 3,000 new Hillary Clinton emails released by the State Department on New Year's Eve contained damning evidence of Western nations using NATO as a tool to topple Libyan leader Muammar Gaddafi. The NATO overthrow was not for the protection of the people, but instead it was to thwart Gaddafi's attempt to create a gold-backed African currency to compete with the Western central banking monopoly.
Right, and I believe we had talked about the fact that that's what he had planned to do. So, I mean, that really just confirms a lot of what people already know. I mean, they, you know, a lot of this stuff that comes out, it's like the spying, like pretty much, okay, we all knew pretty much, but didn't have validation, I guess. And it's validation of what a lot of people, well, I shouldn't say a lot of people, because of course you have that high percentage of people that just watch government, the media, and follow all that bullshit. But the people that, you know, actually follow what's going on.
Yep. Though, to be honest, people today, all you got to take a look at the vast majority. Most of the baby boomers, they're only interested in making sure that their retirement benefits and that the government keeps giving them Medicare. The millennials are more worried about safe spaces and not being offended. So there's only a small group that are willing to listen to the truth as it comes out, and it'll affect their choices in the next election and such.
Yeah, and we'll actually get to back to that safe space thing. I know you had a story on that. Well, we can lead into that after this, but... So going back to the ISIS, the Pentagon CIA wars.
Yeah, what you've got is you've got the intelligence services who backed these, you know, covertly, you know. And if you think about it, in Iraq, the U.S., you know, we'll call them the Pentagon regulars, which is the U.S. military, and the CIA. NGOs, non-governmental organizations.
And that's what they do. I just quickly just want to make a point that, you know, people will a lot of times think like, oh, well, this just happened one time, or they just did this in this instance or whatever. Like, that's what the CIA has been doing since their creation. And you can point to so many different examples of that. That's how they – I mean – the United States Empire has been basically built by covert operations, right? I mean, they have like an under. I mean, it's not an empire like, you know, Rome was an empire or anything. It's not an empire in that sense, but they control all these countries. It's just like covertly, or it's not right in your face, or You know, they don't claim to run the territory, but in a way, they do.
No, what is called, they're called vassal states. And most people don't realize this, but one of the reasons that the United States forced Japan and Germany in World War II to an unconditional surrender is because if you actually dig into the documents of the surrender, each of those countries gave up their sovereignty to the United States. The leaders, when they're elected, have to accede to the will of the United States. This is one of the reasons why Japan was willing to take all their pension money and give the money to the United States in exchange for treasury bonds. It's the reason why Merkel is throwing her people under the bus for the refugee crisis, because Washington wants Europe to, you know, have this division, well, just like it's created the division here in the United States.
Right.
So that people won't start overthrowing their governments.
But that was via war. But I mean, after that, when the CIA started getting involved in all these countries and their business, and you got to
get a little history behind that, and it's going to be real quick. Okay,
go ahead.
The CIA was created out of the OSS.
Right. I know.
The difference was that the military or the department
they were supposed to be temporary as well. At least they because they made a movie on that, and not all of it is, you know, it's a movie. So, you know, a lot of things are in there for entertainment purposes. But they made that movie with Matt Damon and Robert De Niro.
It's called The Good Shepherd.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. And it was supposed to be a temporary agency, and then of course we know no agency is ever temporary in the United States.
Yeah, but here's the gist of it. The OSS used to be under the Department of War. Before it was the Department of Defense, it was the Department of War. It was in 1948.
Right, I know. And then for propaganda purposes, they changed the name because they said, you know, we don't want to be known.
They redid a lot of things. They redid a lot of things in the Department of Defense Act. They segregated and allowed blacks into the military. Two, that they created the United States Air Force from the Army Air Corps. And three, they created the Central Intelligence Agency from that. Now, here, the Central Intelligence Agency was first created by Allen and John Foster Dulles. And for those who don't know, the Dulles brothers, who were deeply involved in Vietnam and the assassination of Kennedy, the Dulles brothers were part of a law firm, Harriman. It was either Harriman Brothers or Harriman and somebody else. They were involved in selling or in doing banking with Adolf Hitler.
Yeah, and they go back further than that. Don't they go back to even World War I?
Well, yeah, but they weren't that old. I mean, they were probably right in their teens at that time. But here's the thing: the Dulles brothers were part of the Operation Paperclip.
Right,
they
right.
went in, and when Eisenhower was rounding up all of the Nazis,
the Dulles brothers,
you can check this out and do a search on it. They went and they co-opted a ton of those in the SS intelligence service. They brought them to the United States, and they formed the CIA based on the Nazi intelligence service. Okay, that's why they're you know. And when Kennedy was going to break up the CIA into 1,000 pieces just before he was killed, okay?
And he fired one of the Dulles brothers as well.
Exactly. And it's kind of ironic because on the Warren Commission,
was one of the brothers, right?
He was on there, so he made sure that no real information got out on it. But here's the key thing on that. After Kennedy was going to break up the CIA, the CIA suddenly said, you know what? We can't be beholden to Congress to give us our money, because at any time Congress, if they don't like what we're doing, they can withhold money and, you know, we're SOL. So that's when they said, we've got to create our own income streams. And guess what? That was what Vietnam was for, to start the drug trade out of Cambodia and Laos. And then, of course, Iran-Contra was the drug trade, the cocaine trade out of South America.
Yeah, I was in
Vietnam
was heroin, and it was what was it, Air America or something?
Yeah,
that they had called it.
That was just one, but you know the
but that was the one with Vietnam
and then the Sandinistas in Nicaragua. That was all about the CIA drug trade.
Right.
Now Afghanistan, the real purpose for going in Afghanistan.
Right, the poppies.
It was the poppies.
The opium.
And heroin, you can see some stories right now where places like Connecticut and New Hampshire are having heroin issues out the yang. Ironically, I want to switch over the real – we'll come back to this. I was listening to Coast to Coast AM the other night, and they had the libertarian radical Jesse Ventura. And Jesse was talking about how legalizing marijuana in Washington and Colorado has changed everything, okay? Because in Washington alone, because they are not going after small-time pot smokers, in the first 2 years, they saved $300 million in policing and the judicial system that they would have had to spend before. $300 million. That doesn't include the tax revenue they're getting from the sale of it.
Well, the taxes, yeah, it's ridiculous. It's like $20 on a $20 bag. I mean, the tax is like 30% or something ridiculous.
But here's the kicker, okay? Jesse was talking about he had a friend who was at a Denver Bronco football game last year. And they were tailgating, and he said – more than three quarters of the people there weren't drinking alcohol. None of them were drinking alcohol. They were smoking pot, and there were no fights.
It's better for you. Alcohol is, in my opinion, probably the worst drug that exists, or at least as bad as the worst drug out there. And
well, he also said that there's a dispensary right across the street from the parking lot there at the stadium, and most of the regulars don't go there, but all of the people from out of town, you know, drop by the dispensary before they're going to the game. It's classic. Anyway, getting back to the thing, because the intelligence services funded all of these NGOs to do these wars, so Congress didn't have to declare war and they could just run, you know, roughshod over the Middle East, and to use these agencies to tear down leaders in countries that they didn't like, i.e. the Libya, Saddam Hussein in Iraq. And of course, then
they would, install like the Shah of Iran and that whole thing where they and that whole backfired in their face. You know, when the people overthrew the government, and I don't know what happened to the Shah. I don't know if he got out or not. I'm sure.
Oh yeah,
do.
He was exiled and went to the United States and stayed there.
But yeah, like things like that, where they installed leaders in different governments throughout the world,
right?
In third world, not always in third world countries, but pretty much. I mean. But that's the type of stuff that I was saying that they were doing. They were essentially, and correct me if I'm wrong, but from what I understand is those type of things. It might not be something like they did in Libya, but it might be something like they did in Iran, like installing a leader. Or I heard that Saddam Hussein was at one point, a CIA asset before he ran Iraq.
Yeah, but No, you don't want to. He wasn't a CIA asset, but he was supported by the CIA, aka the United States. The United States couldn't come out during the Iraq-Iran war and say, "We're for Iraq." No, they used the CIA to funnel arms and you know what? Right. Most of those, nearly all of those quote unquote weapons of mass destruction, the sarin gas and all that. Guess where that came from? United States.
Yeah.
That was the stuff that he that we shipped over there to use against the Kurds and against the Iranians in the Iran-Iraq war.
On Dave Chappelle, it was funny. They had this guy, Negro Damas, like Nostradamus. And he had said, Iraq have weapons of mass destruction? And he said, yeah. And how do you know? Because we have the receipt, meaning, you know, that the United States bought them.
Right. But the real reason that we went after Saddam Hussein is because, getting back to that article I just wrote, here it is. Europe's dream of promoting the euro as a competitor to the U.S. dollar may get a boost from Saddam Hussein. Iraq says that from now on it wants payments for its oil in euros, despite the fact that the battered European currency unit, which has been worth quite a bit more than a dollar lately, has dropped 82 cents. Iraq says we'll no longer accept dollars for oil because it does not want to deal in the currency of the enemy. This is from Time magazine in 2000. And when did we go to war? 2003. They've been planning this since George Bush Jr. Got into office and won the 2000 election.
Right. Well, it's like, you know, and I believe the government is a mafia. It's all of these wars and these operations, for the most part, were business. I don't know. I'm sure there were some that might have been personal, but for the most part, it's business. It had to do with oil or the petrodollar, or a lot of them, from what I understand in talking with you, a lot of the ones in the Middle East, whether it was a covert operation or a quote unquote war, had to do with the petrodollar.
It's all about money.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It's like the mafia. It's business, not personal.
Who used to be in charge of the CIA?
I'm sorry?
Who used to be in charge of the CIA?
Bush.
There you go. There you go. End of story.
Well, that's why, in the second season of Narcos, not that this ruins it for anybody or anything, but they mention, you know, going after Pablo Escobar and the United States helping. And at the time, they're like, yeah, the president, who's also a former head of the CIA, you know, what do you think he's going to do? And what contacts does he have, you know, to be able to go after him?
Well, yeah,
so obviously he's going to, you know, go after him.
You know, who was a lackey? He was on the Bush payroll. And he ensured that the drugs got into the United States and distributed. You know who that was?
Yeah, I'm sure there was a lot of people. Clinton. But Clinton, was laundering money in Arkansas, and they were flying drugs. I'm gonna do a show on this finally next week, a two-part. Show into MENA airport. They're doing a movie on it.
And you know who did? You know what law firm did all the paperwork for it and the money laundering?
No, I'm not sure.
Whitewater.
Okay, that was right.
Rose Law Firm.
That was all part of the Whitewater. There was some guy, Lassiter.
All the papers, all the documents were suddenly disappeared, just like Hillary's emails. All the documents that Rose Law Firm, when it was under subpoena, ooh, we lost it.
Yeah, I don't know if he was part of it or not, but there was some, one of the main guys was this guy Lassiter, and he was gave Roger Clinton a job. There's a video, I actually watched it today. It's funny because I was just going back and going over some of the stuff that I watched on, you know, Iran-Contra and about MENA Airport and Arkansas and whatnot. And there's a video of Roger Clinton, you know, doing lines of cocaine, talking to somebody, and he actually they catch him too because he uses he calls somebody a nigga or something too in the video, you know, showing that that racism, I mean, aspect. I don't know that, you know, that doesn't mean that he hates black people, but I mean they catch him, you know, saying that too, and Bill Clinton's supposed to be this, you know, oh, yeah, he loves black people and everything. But, you know, his brother, I don't know about that. But, yeah, Clinton was very involved in that. And of course, you look at it, that's why these political parties is all bullshit. They don't hate each other. Look, they work together.
The reason the war on drugs was created was so that the CIA would have no competition. That's exactly what it's about. The war on drugs started in the 1970s in the height of Vietnam, 72, when they went into Cambodia and Laos. They set up the drug trade, and that's when Nixon started the war on drugs, because it was to protect the CIA pipelines so that there would be no competition from anybody else. You want to know why we have a drug problem? Why we had to crack cocaine in the 80s? We had that. It's our own government.
Yeah, well, it was the CIA. But people like Rick Ross that they were distributing to, who ran L.A. Essentially when it came to crack. He was the guy for a while. Some of the people in the movie, Kill the Messenger, which was based on Gary Webb, his story. Blandone was one of them that was in the movie who was based on the real guy. And Norman Meneses were two of the guys who were involved from South America that were distributing to Rick Ross and, you know, plenty of other people. So, that might be one of the reasons why they wanted to, you know, the U.S. got involved in Colombia with taking out Escobar. You know,
oh sure. Well, it's the reason.
And then they went after Noriega.
I was that what you were going to say? That time, and I went down to Panama at the time they took down Noriega.
Yeah. Okay. And Noriega was supposed to be their friend. You know, so
Noriega was a U.S. ally and friend until he said, "I'm going to stop, helping you pipeline drugs." It was done. It was over with. You know, you don't mess with the pipeline. Anyway, getting back to the what's going on with the ISIS, okay? You have the CIA backing the Free Syrian Army. And because Putin came in to support Assad and started blasting ISIS into smithereens after a year of Obama just sending them a bunch of arms and the fake, you know, the occasional drone strike, all of a sudden Obama had, you know, was looking like an idiot, incompetent, so he had to start sending over U.S. and NATO troops. And so now you have Pentagon regulars, a.k.a. the U.S. military, fighting CIA-backed Islamic terrorists in ISIS. And so what's going to happen when you start having the first of the military killed by individuals that are paid for by
CIA. But isn't that what happens all the time? Look in what you just said about the drug war. It's almost the same thing. It's sure. You have the CIA giving people drugs so the police and, you know, the DEA can fight them. You know, it's like it's creating these wars and these conflicts and using them to for whatever purpose or exploitation that the government wants to use it for, whether in some cases it's to pass laws, in some cases it's to make money, you know?
Here's something you got to take into consideration, too. In 2008, when the banks were about to collapse, until the taxpayers, ended up bailing them out. The taxpayer bailout was just a drop in the bucket what they needed. But what pulled the European and the U.S. banks through until the Fed started doing their QE programs was the proceeds they were making from drug laundering, money laundering.
Oh, yeah. That came out Wachovia? Alive. Wachovia was one of the big ones, I believe. They were a couple. And all that happened was they got fines. Like, nobody got in trouble.
They didn't get fined when they needed the laundering. They got fined after they got caught. HSBC.
Oh, right.
HSBC.
Obviously, they didn't get...
For forever. Okay? They got caught. And so, oh, no, we got to do the fine. Well, see, that's the problem is that, you know, if you're doing the government's... diligence, as long as you're doing it, they're not gonna do it. But once it gets out, Then they put the screws. And you know what? There's a big reason besides the London Whale and a whole bunch of other things. There's a reason why 2 years ago we had that rash of about 60 or 70 banker deaths. You know what? Those people
That were suicides or supposedly suicides.
Those people could have potentially been subpoenaed to spill the beans. Nope. You know, this is why, you know, I love from a excerpt in Person of Interest, where John Reese used to be with CIA, and you know, they ordered him, you know, his death after he finished a mission. And he told this Navy guy who was really, you know, was on the path to becoming a SEAL and then moving on to something else. He said, one day the agency is going to come up to you. And I would say no, you know, because once you get involved, just take a look at the new Bourne movie. That asset that they had who was part of Iron Hand.
That's my movie.
He killed CIA agents right there. Boom, boom. A team and B team. Boom, boom. While chasing Bourne. They don't care.
Oh, right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They killed their own people.
Yeah. You know, they're all expendable.
Killed them. You know, this is the way they roll. You know, if you get involved.
Well, they work the same way as organized crime. Or as any, you know, a lot of times if, you know, they don't want to leave any witnesses. So a bunch of people will get killed.
You know what the motto of Mossad is? The motto of Mossad is, in deception, we shall do war.
Well, there you go. And that's pretty much what the U.S. has done for the past 100 years.
Yeah. Well, you know what? When you're created out of the ashes of the SS and the Nazi party.
Right. I even think before that. But I mean, that's why I call it an illusion of freedom, because that's exactly what it is. It's an illusion. People that buy into that illusion, you know, that's fine. It's also, you know, hey, I'm living. It's the U.S. did things in a way. This is just my opinion, that, you know, caused people to just sit back and do nothing, because they're like, hey, I'm not going to risk this, this and this. I got it kind of comfortable. You know, why would I do anything? Because it's not in your face. It's not like Hitler, you know, just taking over. It's not like that. They get better and better at it. It seems, but people seem to care less anyway. I think that if it was to come out today that Cheney was behind 9/11, I don't know that anybody would give a fuck. I mean, people would care, but for how long? It came out, you know, how deep the spying goes on people, and people don't give a shit.
No.
It doesn't even happen.
But
when I
don't necessarily blame the people. The programming and dumbing down of America has been going on since the 50s when those Nazis came over. You know, Joseph Mengele was one of those that He brought him over.
Yeah, I know.
And
he was involved in MK Ultra, wasn't he?
Exactly. These were things to dumb down America with rock and roll.
It's all designed.
The plastic MTV 80s.
This is the shit that people don't believe. They think you're paranoid or you're nuts. Not you, but I'm saying, if you talk about, because that's what I say all the time. I'm like, all this shit is totally by design. You know, all the TV shows and the commercials and the, you know, government media. I mean, in the 20s, they had an FBI guy that had an office in Hollywood that would, you know, they were involved in media from the beginning. It's just crazy, you know, how much. And of course, schools is just the obvious. But I mean, it goes beyond what people would think. You know, it's not just school or not just the news. You know, it's everything. It's football. It's you know, TV shows. It's so many different things that you probably, a lot of them still don't even realize because it's subconscious.
Well, and also it's devaluing the dollar to the point that both parents have to work.
Yeah,
long hours just to survive and
well,
get
then
by.
Then the government can control your kids and bring them up themselves. And of course, you had said that on another show when we were talking about it, that in like the 60s, you know, one parent could work and they could own a house and have a car, and you can't do that anymore. I mean, it's hard enough, you know, and I make okay money, and we'll say I'll say this because I think I said it before. I mean, combined, me and my fiance make over $100,000 a year before taxes, of course. After taxes, fucking, it's insane. But I mean, you would think that would be enough. It's nothing. I mean, it's really, seriously, it's, I mean, if it was $100,000 after taxes, that, you know, there'd be a big difference there. But I mean, before, you know, when you gross that much, and it's a little more than that, but when you gross that much, it's not a lot of money. It's not. And I don't know how people, you know, and I'm up there in like the 60th or something percentile, or maybe even I think even higher, which is insane because you have all these people raising families on a lot less money than I make. And I'm like, how the fuck do you even do that? And it comes to exactly what you said. I mean, not even do you have both parents working? Sometimes you have both parents working and one of them working two fucking jobs. And the, you know, between school and television and daycare, if you know, your kid goes to daycare, your kid's not even raised by the parents. And, you know, and they want Obama wants preschool at age 3, mandatory free preschool. It's so the government can get your kids at an even younger age.
Well, see, here's the thing. We'll jump into the political side real quick. You know, when it comes to whoever you want in the election, okay, you're not people have to realize, even the libertarians, you're not going to get everything. Okay, Rome is not built in a day, so you got to decide for your individual life which candidate is going to offer you the best opportunity for freedom. Okay, you're not going to get 100%, so get that out of your mind. Gary Johnson talks a good game, but you know what? He's a neocon from going way back. He's for TPP. He's for forced vaccinations. He's not a libertarian. The one thing that stands out to me the most with Trump is that he wants to get education out of the federal government to the states and allow everybody individually to choose vouchers.
You know, everything else Trump has said is totally anti-freedom. He's an authoritarian.
That's fine. That's what I'm saying. Is
he's a total authoritarian. And you know what? I know we disagree on this, but I mean, your vote doesn't mean shit when you live in a country of 300,000 or 300 million people, more than that. Not that everybody out of that 320 million or 300 million vote, obviously, because you have people that don't vote. You have people under 18. But it doesn't mean much. And the whole thing is fucking rigged anyway, because even if you don't think it's rigged by the powers, I call them the powers that be, there it's rigged by between the political parties and the money. And I mean,
we already know that the emails came out that you know,
it's
that
all rigged.
Bernie Sanders was beaten before he even started, and that the DNC worked to ensure that he didn't, and even rigged California.
Well, but look at even the candidates that you get to begin with. The average person can't run for fucking president or can't run for, you know, most things. And these are the people that are controlled. And it doesn't matter if Trump or Hillary get in there. You know, I know that, you know, you're at least, you have been a Trump supporter, and I know a lot of people are, because they think he's anti-establishment and all this shit. It's a bunch of bullshit. If he gets in there, it's because they wanted him there. if Hillary gets in there, it's because they wanted her there. I think she might die in office the way things are going right now.
Look, you're anti-government, so you already have a slight bias off the top. Did you see the article today or yesterday where Goldman Sachs told all of its partners, you will not donate a dime to
Donald No, but I heard
Trump.
You mention it. But it's not just that. It's that I paid attention to everything
that the establishment and he's going to do it.
Okay,
you're basing an opinion.
No, I'm
of
basing
how
it
feel,
right on what happens. No, I'm basing it also though off of what Trump has said. I watched all those town halls. I watched all those debates because I, you know, while I'm working, I listen to, you know, shit all day because I have a job where I'm, you know, doing a lot of independent work on my own. So I listened to all of those. I heard him say all the shit that he said. I mean, he's pretty bad, man. It's not, you know, so if
look,
even
look,
if
I'm
I
not trying, I'm not trying to sell anybody on Trump. What I'm saying is my whole point was is you've got a whole thing of lesser of evils, okay?
I hate the lesser of two evils.
What in your particular life does a candidate have to offer that will benefit you? That's all I'm saying. Because you know what? The reason that the system is the way it is goes back to our grandparents and parents who allowed it to happen, and now it's too far gone. So you can fight it. Well,
it's been too far gone for a long, long time.
I'll cheer you on the good fight, but you know, it's to the point you can't fight City Hall.
No, you can't fight the system. Well, you can't fight exactly because you can't fight the system through the system because of that. Exactly what you said. It's too far gone, and it's been too far gone for a long, long time. Before even my grandparents, I would say. I would say maybe my great-grandparents, maybe.
Look,
but it's been too far gone for a long time. I say non-compliance, but you need enough people to get together and say, we're not going to take this shit. And you know what else? And I know you're going to disagree with me on this, but the only way there's no checks and balances in government. I don't give a fuck what they say. The only way to have a checks and balance would be the people, because the government to me is like a corporation. They don't check each other. If the people had enough fucking hardware as, you know, the NYPD and had their own army, so if the government were to, you know, just do whatever they wanted and they had an army to say, look, you know, not to even actually do anything about it, but to as a threat, then you have there's your check and balance, because the only government rules by force. And that's just a fact.
Not always. The government rules by three different things: bribes, coercion, extortion. Okay. 100 million people rely upon the government from bribes, welfare. That means that they have absolute control over the people, because the people willingly gave up their own freedoms and sovereignty to accept welfare. Pure and simple. Okay. That was a government, obviously a government plan, but the people willingly came like sheeple. That's the way people are. The other is done by extortion. You take who is it?
Well, extortion is based on force. Extortion is that's the definition of extortion.
But I said,
it's if you don't do this, I'm going to break your legs.
You didn't listen to me. I said they use three different things. Force is part of it, but it's not the only thing.
Right, but I'm saying I consider extortion.
The carrot is welfare. The stick is somebody like you.
No, you're right with welfare, but hold on, with extortion, I consider that force, because in the end, that's how they rule, mostly by extortion, because it's all threats. They don't always use force.
Exactly.
It's the threat of force.
There, you know what?
That's what I mean. So I just want to clarify what I mean, that when I say force, that includes extortion.
I understand, but what I'm saying is that there's three pillars. Yes, force is part of it, and it goes progressively stronger. But the first thing is always to dumb down the people and make it, you know, and they did so with
definitely.
They did so with, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You didn't need a lot of force to that. If you get people to turn away from looking at their government and being part of the system to then become materialists and only about self-aggrandizement and self-gratification, you know what? You control the people. That's the first thing they did. The second thing that they did was they said that, you know, if a bunch of these people in poverty didn't have a job and didn't have any money, then they're going to riot and they're going to tear the house down like they did in 68. So let's give them a bunch of money and placate them. And that's what they did with welfare. Then, of course, you get the Irwin Schiffs. Irwin Schiff is the father of Peter Schiff, the banker and economist. Irwin Schiff wrote a book about how the IRS, paying the IRS your taxes, is voluntary. He proved it. It was validated. But when he went to the court, he went to a court where the judges were automatically going to rule against him and go against the rule of law. And they threw him in jail.
Yeah, they do whatever they want.
They threw him in jail and said, we'll let you out if you stop publishing this book. That's the extortion part. He said no, and he died in prison. Then, of course, is the force. The force is the instances like –
any law is
what the police are doing now.
Right. You know? But every law is based on force, because in the end, they will use force if you do not obey.
The world from day one has been about force. Cain was jealous about Abel and killed him. Okay. From day one, mankind has used force to achieve his own agenda. That will never change unless you program somebody with so much drugs that they're docile.
Well, that's right? In a way what they're trying to do, as you were saying.
Yeah, but
you
they still need the people to be productive, brainwashing, so they can't make them zombies.
No, no, I'm not productive. Saying through drugs, but I'm saying through right. They, you know, they want people that won't force them to use force. They want people that will comply. Because
1984, Big Brother. They didn't want you to live under Big Brother. They wanted you to love
right. Big Brother. Well, because right, they didn't want you to disobey. They want you to comply, because they don't have to use force.
Right.
But what I'm saying is every law is based off of, in the end, force. Right. But yeah, I mean, ideally they'd rather brainwash people and have them comply and not rebel, so they don't use force. And that happens most of the time.
There are a lot of laws that are out there that the government didn't force on people. What happened is one or two malcontents had something happen against them.
Yeah,
they started a big thing, and they forced their legislators by, you know, squeaky wheel theory to impose this law.
Drinking
when
and driving.
The crime was actually being affected on like 0.1%.
Well,
it's
like drinking and driving. The
mad group and all that.
Well, yeah, drugs too.
A lot of laws are because of one or two people, you know, activists scream up a thing and then force it. You know, that's what's happening with the safe spaces and the Black Lives Matter.
Well, it's also happening with, and I'll just say this real quick because we can talk about that, is and this is the show that I got, Jesus, the most listens I've gotten in a long time, at least on YouTube. They're schedule wanting a drug called Kratom, or it's pronounced Kratom. It's all, I don't know if you've heard of it before. They sell it at head shops and smoke shops. You can order it online. It's all natural. It actually helps people get off opiates. And it's just a plant that's ground up into powder. It's been on the DEA's list for a while. And I don't know that she specifically had anything to do with it, but here's an example. A mother swears her son committed suicide because he took this drug. Now, of course, the kid was on all these antidepressants, but she swears it was because of this. And, you know, at the end of it, she's like, yep, I got a lot of work to do. Now, she was in Florida. They ended up banning it in Florida. And I don't know if she started a group or, but that's the type of thing that, you know, you were talking about. But sorry, you were saying that now these safe spaces, they're actually doing it at California State, L.A. Is that where?
Yeah. The California university system. You know, it's kind of funny. Or it's kind of sad.
Is it UCLA or Cal State?
CLSA.
Yeah, it's the state university system, right?
What is it? California.
Cal State.
Yeah. Yeah, Cal State. I just say the university system.
But yeah, they have like, you know, California State, Long Beach, California State, L.A., California, you know, whatever. They have tons of them all over the fucking.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. Cal is Berkeley.
Yeah, because it's University of California at Berkeley, and UCLA is University of California at Los Angeles. So they have the university system, and then they have the state university. I don't know what the fucking difference is, but yeah, well, they have California State University. But yeah, sorry.
When is that point? That the blacks spent blood, sweat, tears, and everything in the 1950s and 60s to end segregation, to integrate in schools, in universities, in sports programs, and in all of society. Okay. The Martin Luther King, the whole nine yards. And now with Black Lives Matter, they want to they want to segregate themselves away from whites.
Well, they were also communists. So
at the CLSA, they are going to set up that any black who wants to can have a black roommate and doesn't have to have a white roommate.
Now, how did they determine that? I was thinking of this earlier, right? So if you're Dominican, you know how a lot of Dominicans are like dark. Or what if you're Jamaican? Is it just based on the color of your skin? So
separate the Latinos too. Yeah, the whole.
Well, no. I'm saying if you're Dominican, you know, you ever seen like a Dominican that's like they look like they're black, but they're from the Dominican Republic. Like there's a lot of dark.
David Ortiz from the Dominican Republic. He's
right.
He's black.
Manny
black.
Ramirez. It was another example.
Sammy Sosa.
So, yeah, he was actually really dark.
Remember, when you apply for college, there's a nice little thing. What race are you? They don't have to go find people in face to face. All they got to do is take those applications, say you're Latino, you're black, you're Latino, right. You're
well. I guess they have black Latinos and white Latinos. They divide people that way. So I guess if you're a black Latino, then you would count as black for the purposes of being in the safe space. Yeah, it's. Pretty fucking ridiculous. I think if you want to, although if you want to request, I mean, because that's like a whole unit, but if you're looking for a roommate, I think you should have your choice of, you know, who you want to room with.
Well, yeah, but if you've got a university system of 40 to 50,000 people in one school,
yeah.
You know what? It's a churn and burn. They don't have enough administrators to deal with that. It's a random thing. You know what? You're assigned to room 207. You're assigned to room 210. End of story. That's the way it goes. You know, do you think bureaucrats actually take the time to do their jobs? No.
So, but I mean, this is, from what I understand, like a whole, what do you call them? Like a whole dorm, right? It's like a black, it's a black dorm. It's
and
not like a roommate.
Think about this. We are putting so much money, so much effort, so much into segregation again. And we're creating division.
Well, that's the whole purpose. And, you know.
Yeah, but they want it. It's not like the government's forced imposing it. The millennials who are brainwashed.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Because who do you
be offended and all of a sudden, blah.
Right,
you know.
But who do you think's behind, you know, Black Lives Matter? Because if you go to
Soros.
Yeah, you it's have.
When someone hacked Soros's emails, it came out that one of his organizations funded the Ferguson protests and Black Lives Matter.
Right. If you look at their platform, it's obviously from a progressive platform. They even mention global warming. So it's the way it's written, and they mention the LGBT community. It's not, you can tell that their platform is a bunch of shit. It's from you know, it's from white people that are funding it that have a communist agenda. I mean, I don't know if you looked at that picture that I had posted where it has a website under it. Now, the website, of course, doesn't have the name of what the website's really about in the URL, but you go to the website and it's Communist Revolutionary is the name of the website. And it's on the Black Lives Matter signs. I don't even think the people holding the signs knew. I mean, maybe they did, but they might not have even known that what it was about. So I think you have a certain amount, not the kids that are going to these dorms, not them, but people that are going to the protest. I think you have a certain amount of people that don't know what it's like what it's really about, that they don't know that it's really a front for a communist agenda that's being funded by these big fucking progressives that are trying to take over and, you know, turn the country into a socialist and communist nation.
There you go. How many people are waking up to it? Well, not too many.
No, and it's funny that, and that's why I guarantee you the reason that the URL they used was just initials was because of the fact that they didn't want people to know that, you know, this is what we're really about. Now, the guys at the top probably know, but that's about it. You know, in some people, I'm sure. But now, I mean, they released the platform, so everybody knows. But what I'm saying is people that were just going to protest, that you have, hey, somebody, a cop killed somebody, and I'm going to go to the protest, you know, and I support Black Lives Matter because I think they're about, you know, police killings. I'm just, you know, not me, but I'm saying somebody going to a protest. And what I'm saying is I think the majority of those people, at least they should know by now, but maybe they still don't, that Black Lives Matter is a total communist front. And it's not even a communist front that's run by black people. It's a communist front that has a political agenda of people like Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders and fucking, you know, these multimillionaires that are funding it to push their agenda. And I did a whole show on it. And that's why I don't support Black Lives Matter. You know, not to mention the fact that they turned it all about race instead of being about the cops. So now everybody's arguing about race instead of looking at, well, we got fucked up cops. But, you know, who cares about the fucked up cops? Just, you know, federalize them and send them to, you know, racial training and then everything's okay now. No, because if you look at the facts, cops are killing everybody. They're killing all races. They're harassing all races. You know, yes, do they harass black people a higher percentage? Yeah, they do, based on population, you know.
And based on
percentage of population.
Areas, but, yeah, I mean, per capita areas where crime is committed.
Right, right. But, you know, but they do also in, you know, nice neighborhoods when they see black people. And I think it's more about prejudice than anything else, that they think, you know, young black kids are criminals. Not necessarily that they hate them, or certain types of black kids. Like if you dress a certain way, you must be a criminal. If you dress like hip, you know, the hip hop style or something, you know, shit like that. I don't necessarily think that a lot of these cops just hate black people and want to kill them. But they're definitely, there's an issue with the cops. And, you know, of course, my opinion is get rid of police. But, and
hey,
replace them with
hey,
a free market.
Guess what? Guess what? The police stood down in Chicago over Labor Day.
Well,
did you hear about that?
No, but you can tell us.
Yeah, Labor Day, the police union told all the departments that you will not give overtime on the holiday weekend, and so
well, in Chicago
they stood down, and you know what? Murders, there were something like
murders.
40 yeah. murders that day, and just it went wild. I tell you what, you take away the police. Now, should we have the police in the form that they are now? No. But if you take away the police and think that people will police themselves, well, that occurred, and it was called the Wild West.
Well, nobody said, first of all, I didn't say anything about having free market solutions for protection, and because the main point, and police don't do this, first of all, let's remember the fact that the main thing that police do is throw people in jail and try to generate revenue for the state. I mean, that's what they do, and they arrive after the crime happens. Now, what's important and I think you'd agree with this, is that people's safety is important, and that people have protection is important, right?
Yeah, that was the original thing. Protect right. the people and protect and, the property.
Right, and their property. Companies like, I don't even want to call them a company because they're so much more than that, like the Detroit Threat Management Center is an example of that. So I'm not saying you throw everything out the window and say, well, we end the, you know, I call them the government police, and that, you know, people are just left to defend themselves. That's not, but I think when you have a monopoly on force, like the police do, they have no incentive to do anything.
But in all honesty, like I said, you know, the original police department came out of Boston in like the early 1800s. And the purpose behind it, of course, was you had tons and tons and tons of immigrants coming in.
All the bad things came out of Boston, except for the Revolutionary War, I guess, because public schools came out of fucking Massachusetts, too.
Yeah. Well, but the point is that most of the immigrants coming in had lived their lives and only knew European law living under monarchies, okay? And that the government was the system. So here they come to this new free area. They haven't learned how to do this. You know, you remember that movie with Leonardo DiCaprio, whatever, Gangs of New York?
Okay. Yeah.
That was the late 1800s, early 1900s, right. And police were just barely into it. I mean,
I think it was early 1900s.
Yeah, but that's the way it was in most of the eastern cities.
Right, okay?
But the political machines ran the city, and the innocent people, they were caught in the crossfire, and they had no recourse.
Right. Again, though, you're saying that, like, I'm saying if you end the government police, that I'm saying do that and don't do anything else. What I'm saying is there are free – I'd much rather have the Detroit Threat Management Center in my city than the Las Vegas Police Department, because – They're not only going to prevent crime, because they're going to actually protect people, and they're going to do it in a nonviolent way. So, you know, and then other companies could compete with them if they wanted to. Then it gives incentive to actually do a good job.
Yeah, but that's a rare anomaly, because you know what? The states and the federal government have been privatizing prisons, and guess what?
I don't want it. No, I'm not talking. There's a difference between privatization and outsourcing. Okay, prisons, they're outsourcing. The Detroit Threat Management Center is not a government. Has nothing to do with government. They right, do
the,
not have the power.
The prisons
of government.
Are corporations. The prisons are corporate owned.
They're paid in tax money.
Well, yeah, but okay. Who's paying the threat management?
That's outsourcing.
The people themselves are paying for the protection.
Exactly.
Okay. Well, that's
corporations pay. They do things for free for people because they have contracts with corporations. That there's a difference between privatization and outsourcing. Now, prisons is outsourcing. It's not really privatization because it's the federal government taking their money and hiring a corporation to do what the government does, right? So yeah. You'd agree with me that there's a difference between privatization, which means I go and hire them myself. Government has nothing to do with them. And outsourcing, where the government takes your tax money and then, no, that's worse. Right. Outsourcing is worse than having the government do it.
Something like the threat management thing. They have to have oversight, because if they arrest somebody, the state is the one who's going to prosecute and indict that individual for a crime. So this, you know, this private organization who's doing the policing.
Well, they're not police. That's the whole point.
No, policing. It's a verb. It's not just a noun.
No, policing. But they're not policing. They're not arresting. They don't arrest people. That's where it gets into a whole
complicated. If you get rid of the police,
it gets into a whole complicated scenario that we don't have time.
People can run roughshod if they're not allowed to arrest or to even shoot them if they have to.
Well, that's when it gets into the whole thing of the scenario of how it would work in a free market society that is not the. Basically, to explain how it would work would take me a lot longer, but it.
I agree, but you know what? Back in the Andy Griffiths and Barney Fife days,
there's a scenario where it would work. I'll just put it that way.
For the Norman Rockwell days, the law enforcement officer was one with the community. Okay. The people could trust them because the police officer spent time knocking on doors, coming by and eating dinner with somebody down the street or whatever. That's the way it was. And then all of a sudden,
if you think people weren't getting killed back then like they are now, then, you know, come on.
Sure, but it wasn't as prevalent. You know, the other side of the coin,
we just didn't know about it.
The other side of the coin is that until the start of the 20th century, half the people lived in rural areas, half the people lived in urban areas. Now it's 97% people packed into a sardine city. And so it's not really surprising that, you know, you have so much crime in that small of an area because people just naturally, you know, when you put people, you know, it would be like if you were in a corporation and you're in a meeting for, say, 16 hours discussing a budget or whatever, all of a sudden you're going to – something comes out of somebody's mouth. You're going to get pissed. You're going to beat them up. You're going to, you know, just get fired. You're just going to do that. If you have so many people in a small amount of area, you know, trying to live – as you know, when we were spread out across the country, it was much, 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 much different period and era. But that going aside, I know we've digressed quite a bit.
Right.
One of the things I wanted to ask you is, did you hear about at the G20, the stare down between Vladimir Putin and Barack Obama?
Yeah, I heard that. In
your Skype, I posted a link and I got a picture of it. So if you want to pull that up, anybody can go to roguemoney.net and it's the first story up there. But there's a picture. They had a stare down for about 2 minutes. And interestingly enough, 2 days after that, last night, somebody crossed over the median full speed on the highway and slammed into Putin's the car that
he uses to drive around in.
Yeah, and his chauffeur was killed, but he wasn't in there.
So it's from what I understand, it's possible that people were trying to kill him, or
either it was probably a warning shot or it was an outright assassination attempt. But the question is it coming from the fact that Barack Obama was snubbed even by the Chinese? You know, they made him get out the back of the airplane. They didn't pull a ladder up to the front and give him a red carpet treatment. They made him come out the back of the plane. And one of the Chinese officials started getting into a shouting contest with National Security Advisor Rice and said, "Hey, this is our airport. It's our country. You're going to do what we tell you to do." There is no respect around the world for the United States. Anyway, the reason I point this up is it because of the stare down? Is it because of a thing? Well, or could it be something else? And here's important, because right now, the petrodollar, you know, if you want to see what holds up the United States and allows for this warmongering, it's the control over the petrodollar and the reserve currency. On Monday, Russia and Saudi Arabia signed a joint oil market stabilization statement aiming at tackling a global glut. Russia's energy minister called it a historic moment in relations between OPEC members and non-members, while experts believe this will be the harbinger of a new alliance that will finally replace OPEC. the whole petrodollar system is based on Saudi Arabia and OPEC selling dollars or oil and dollars. If OPEC breaks up and moves in and makes a new agreement with Russia, who's the world's leading producer, the dollar is toast. Now, here's something else that happened, okay? Two private Iranian banks will open branches in Munich, officials confirmed Monday, as the Islamic Republic looks for ways around ongoing barriers to international financing. Here's the final thing that it said. Parviz Aghili, director general of the Mideast Bank, told the American Free Press, Iran's central bank is also now working with its German counterpart and several banks in the country to settle oil exports in euros. Iran is now going right into the middle of NATO and the EU, opening, and they're going to sell their oil in euros. Then you have Saudi Arabia and Russia looking at breaking up OPEC, creating a new alliance, which is going to sell oil in either euros, rubles, or yuan. You wonder why there's all this talk and all this push to try to create a World War III against Putin? It's because the United States is about to lose the only thing that's propping up the entire government and economic system, the dollar. And once that goes, goodbye.
So is that something where they will try to start other wars in the Middle East or go after Saudi Arabia? Or
they'll go after everybody. They'll go after everybody who stands in the way of the petrodollar and the reserve currency. Now, the question is, China, last week, at the beginning of the month, they are now internationalizing and issuing MSDR. And think about this, okay? The World Bank and the IMF are both controlled by the U.S. They were formed out of Bretton Woods. The U.S. pretty much has domination over them. The two leaders of the World Bank and the IMF both publicly said they support China being in charge of the SDR internationalization. That's a shot at the U.S. saying that we support China to have the new reserve currency be put out there. The world is rejecting the U.S. It's rejecting the dollar. It's rejecting everything going forward, and it's being laid out. And that G20, like I said, the Chinese official made Obama get out of the back of the bus, the back of the plane. He didn't get out the front. They didn't put a ladder up to it. He had to use an emergency exit. They gave Putin the red carpet treatment, and then there was a stare down between Putin and Obama, and then there was this agreement. The whole world is isolating the United States and rejecting it. And we're just sitting there wondering what Kim Kardashian's going to do.
Well, that's because of them, you know, building this empire and going around and doing whatever they want to do to any country they want to do it to, and not looking at the ramifications of what they do.
Exactly. On a different note, a couple of Bitcoin issues. I think I told you, or when we talked on a couple weeks ago, or maybe a month ago, about that individual who was arrested in Florida, and the judge threw out all the charges because she said that Bitcoin is not money.
Yeah, that it's. But that I thought that had even happened. In a federal court.
No, it was a Florida court.
Well, no, there, but I thought it also had been declared in a federal court in another case as well that Bitcoin is not money. A government agency had declared it's not money or something.
A U.S. District Court of New York. So you're talking one little tiny appellate court. It wasn't like federal statute.
Right, right.
They said it was a security. And it would be taxed like capital gains. That's what they determined. Well, yeah, a security is a financial instrument. It may not necessarily be money, but the treasury is the equivalent of the dollar, but it's a bond. It's a financial instrument, but it's treated like AAA, like a dollar. So, you know, that's up there. Anyway, following that ruling by the judge, a Florida legislator is drafting legislation and could see Bitcoin recognized as money in the state of Florida. Now, here's the hardest part. States don't have the right.
Sorry, he's drafting a bill?
Drafting a bill that could see Bitcoin recognized as money in the state of Florida.
Yeah, like, I mean, they don't have the, technically, the authority to do that, right?
No, they because it's, you know, like Texas, Oklahoma, Utah, and Arizona is doing it. They're talking about creating a form of money, a new form of money in the state, but it's all backed by gold and silver because that's constitutional money. But there's a lot of problems with this woman, you know, this state senator.
Well, didn't the original judge say it's not money because you can't hide it under the mattress?
That was one of the caveats she used.
Yeah.
Really what she was saying is, I don't understand what the hell.
Well, judges are fucking idiots because they're just people who got elected usually. And the reason they became a judge was because they couldn't make it as a fucking defense attorney.
Most judges don't have any financial understanding anyway, because that's why the banks got away with the robo signing. The stuff was so complex in the mortgage foreclosure thing that eventually they just the district attorneys went to the banks and said, okay, give us $25 billion combined and we'll let you slide. You know. So anyway, here's the other thing is. Isn't it an anathema to the mission and purpose of Bitcoin to be controlled and regulated by a government agency? Because really, if they declare it as money, doesn't that mean that the state now has the power to regulate it? And the whole purpose behind Bitcoin was a decentralized currency outside the controls and purview of the of governments?
Yeah, but they can't. They can only regulate it so much anyway, just because of how it's created.
They can tax it
if they know that, but they don't even know who has what. It's harder now. From what I understand, you can do everything anonymously. You have to be careful though. It's not just
true, but
you got to make sure that you're doing certain things.
But here's the problem: it's not about the individual. Okay, if a retailer wanted to accept Bitcoin and they sell you like a shirt for some Bitcoin,
the tax that they put on it.
Yeah, that retailer has to record and file taxes on the income they get for, you know, for sales tax.
Right.
So that's, you know, it is going to affect the retailers far more than it affect, you know, if I was a dentist and off the books, I just, for some Bitcoin, did some services for you. But if you're selling products from a retailer, that stuff's got to be, you know.
Well, I mean, that's going on now. So I don't know. A lot of the transactions are on the internet, but like there's hotels in Las Vegas that take Bitcoin. So
right.
I assume that they charge a tax just to protect themselves.
But
because you pay tax on revenue, not on. You know, it doesn't matter what they paid in.
As long as there are exchanges, places like the, you know, the hotel in Vegas, they'll accept Bitcoin and they'll just go out and get it, you know, exchange it for dollars. And then they pay their taxes from the dollar base value of what the service that they sold you for Bitcoin.
Right. But what I'm saying is the person that pays in Bitcoin they'll charge them tax, I'm assuming.
Maybe.
Because they're going to have to file that as revenue that they generated,
well, sure.
Right? That they had to pay taxes on. So
sure,
but
a person buying something doesn't have to pay taxes on the purchase. You only have to pay taxes if you make a profit from selling something.
No, but they can charge. Right. They're
right.
Not
the
one paying the taxes, but the retailer passes it on to you is what
right.
I'm saying.
Exactly.
So I'm sure that they do pass it on to the person. But I would think no matter what, currently now, again, that they would pay taxes on it because they'd still have to declare it as revenue. You know, I know on the internet there's the rule that if you don't have a physical presence in that in a state, that you don't have to pay taxes.
Yeah, they've been trying to
change that. I know they wanted
the internet for a long.
They wanted to come up with some ridiculous thing where like you'd have to pay taxes in 50 fucking states, and you'd have to file. It just I saw a couple of the bills that they were talking about. It was just ridiculous. But I know currently, so if you're an internet business and you're based in Nevada, only people that are purchasing in Nevada, you only get charged on those taxes. You only have to pay tax to the state of Nevada on those purchases. And then anybody buying in any other state, you're not getting charged on. But what I'm saying is I would assume that with any Bitcoin purchases now, they would follow the same rules because they're still generating revenue, even though it's being paid for with Bitcoin. It's like it doesn't matter. It could be paid for with fucking gold. I mean, or fucking it could be traded, but it's still revenue that was generated. You know what I mean? So I would think that they would still have to pay taxes because they generated
sure.
that revenue.
The problem is that because Bitcoin is recognized as a currency, maybe not necessarily by governments or whatever, but it's a currency. It has a relational value to other currencies. You know, it's like what, 575 US dollars to one Bitcoin. So it's considered a currency in relation to other value. The problem is like all other currencies, since we don't have a singular global currency, it fluctuates. So see, that's the thing is if you bought your Bitcoin back in 2009 for a nickel a piece and you've held them all this time and then you go to use it to purchase things or you exchange it for $575 worth of, you know, US dollars, you're going to pay profit on, you know, the difference in that if it's considered security. But if it's considered money, you don't have to pay tax on money because money actually fluctuates.
Are you talking about the person that has the Bitcoin?
Yeah, when you go through the exchanges.
But again, you know, they would.
If I do currency trading, okay, like on the Forex market, if I want to buy US dollar versus.
Right, and you exchange, you get charged a percentage.
Well,
like
I get a fee off the top. But if I make a profit on my trade when I close,
oh, you got to pay taxes on that.
I pay capital gains
like
taxes.
Like it's income.
On
right,
that.
Right. I see
that's
what you're saying.
That's currency trading, you know?
So you're saying that the way it's going to affect the users or owners of Bitcoin is that they'll have to pay that tax when they exchange it for dollars. And right now, they're not.
And see, this is where it's being hashed out in the central banks and the major banks of the world. I don't know if I mentioned a couple weeks ago that there are four major banks.
Just to take a step back, because I'm curious about this. How do they know if you made a profit, though?
Well, if you're a retailer and you accept it. And
no,
you sold-
not that. I understand that part of it, retail part. I'm saying if you buy, because you're saying if you're exchanging dollars for euros and you're saying if you make a profit, because you're investing, that's investing in. You're talking about investing in currency,
well,
right?
It's,
how do they know that you made a profit? Because they don't know when you bought it, though,
If I do,
you know what I mean?
Trading, I get a timestamp. Okay, I have to do it through a platform. I have to do it through a platform that controls the currency markets, so it's timestamped, and it's I get a report out. So. Yeah, I mean, I do that, and they're not going to take taxes out, but you know how it is with FATCA.
Are they going
to
send you like
every financial institution and demand to see who all the depositors are? And if I don't pay the taxes, you know what? I've evaded taxes, so I just put it on there. And mostly, I do for currency trading for just fun.
So you actually do it? I didn't know.
I put in $300, and I've been just running trades at a dime or 20 cents a pip. So I really, I made, God, I think I made $100 over the course of 2 years. But I just do it for fun, something to run in the background. But people do this, you know.
No, I know people do it like with, you know, because millions of dollars, depending on
the forex market, you know, is like 7 times bigger than the stock markets.
The currency market?
No, it's even bigger than that. It's a $7 trillion per day.
I didn't realize that. I knew that it was something, you know, it was big and it was something that people invest in. I just didn't realize how big it is. So I see what you're saying, how it's going to affect the person who exchanges Bitcoin. But see, this is the whole thing. If you're anonymous,
But here, this gets my whole point about Bitcoin, okay? Like gold and silver. You know what? If I bought gold and silver and I just hoarded it till I died, what I bought some metal and just held it. Gold and silver is supposed to be money. It's supposed to be used for a purpose, okay? The reason right now where I'm getting rid of my dollars and moving into gold and silver is because the dollar's devaluing and I want to protect my wealth.
Right.
When the new financial system comes on, whether it's going to be the SDR, whether it's going to be a gold-backed yuan, whether the whole thing changes, then when the new currency in the U.S. comes, I can change my gold and silver for that new currency. I'm going to be well ahead of, you know, because it's going to be devalued. People are going to lose most of their wealth if they had stocks, if they have bonds, if they have keep some dollars in the bank, because the new currency is going to come out. It's going to be devalued between 30% and 70%. It means your purchasing power is going to be lost by 70%. And we're going to move to, you know, being able to afford what we did in the 1940s and 50s. But if you have gold and silver, then automatically you're back into the middle class. You're fine. So I'm using the same thing with Bitcoin. Holding Bitcoin or seeing its value, what's the point? Bitcoin is money. It's to be used for purchasing.
No, but I'm talking about you can use
products and services.
Right, but you can do all that anonymously.
But you are limited in the amount. I mean, the environment of people who use Bitcoin is limited.
Right.
Because a big retailer like, say, Target, if they're going to accept Bitcoin on a regular basis, they have to pay hundreds of thousands of dollars to now have their point of sale system, their POS system, be able to accept Bitcoin, to be able to transact it, to be able to go automatically out to the Forex markets to see what its value in dollars is, make that exchange, you know, in a nanosecond, come back and say, okay, it's going to cost you.
Right.
You know,
that's why they don't accept
of a Bitcoin. Boom.
That's why they don't accept things like gold, because the same thing. Right. That, and I think
eventually you can buy gift cards
with Bitcoins. This is what a lot of people do. They buy gift cards with Bitcoins,
exactly.
Right? And then they go to the store and use it that way.
But you're still limited.
No, you are. You definitely are. I mean, but it's getting bigger as far as the retailers that accept it. But no, you're definitely limited.
Right.
You can't just go to, you know, the store down the street and fucking use Bitcoin.
Right. See, and money is in relation to time, okay? Is if it's going to take me if I want to buy something and there's only two places in my city that I can buy what I want at the time with Bitcoin, you know, I've got to take in the time factor. It'd be the equivalent of, you know, some people will get a bunch of coupons and on a Saturday morning they'll drive around to 5 different grocery stores thinking they're going to save, you know, 10 cents more at this grocery store from this grocery store, but they've lost it all in gas, you know, driving all around. It's the same thing with Bitcoin. If I've got to deal with trying to go someplace and do that, when instead I could just, you know, in 5 minutes go down to the Quick Trip and go buy a Coke for a dollar rather than go try to, you know, find a singular place that's going to sell me a Coke for Bitcoin. You know, it's in finance, it's called critical mass. Once something new reaches that point of critical mass where 51% of the population accepts it, then it's there. It's not even close. Exactly. And so it's doing well and it's a great concept. But here's the problem is the blockchain technology is about to backfire on those who believe in cryptocurrencies, because when
just so people who don't know and make sure I understand as well, the blockchain is a list of every transaction that anybody has ever done with Bitcoin.
Well, that's with Bitcoin alone. The blockchain is a technology that is like, think of it as a super database for financial transactions.
Right, but I mean for Bitcoin,
right.
The blockchain is every Bitcoin transaction that's ever right. happened. But you're saying you can use it. I mean, the concept is applicable to anything.
Right. Think of the blockchain as like a Windows operating system, and Bitcoin is an application that you run on Windows.
Right, right.
Okay. That Windows operating system, the blockchain, can create an application for it and use it that has nothing to do with Bitcoin.
Right, right.
This is now being done. There's four major banks: Santander out of Spain, Deutsche Bank, an Italian bank, and one U.S. bank. They are creating on the blockchain technology, they're creating their own cryptocurrency. They're going to use it as a settlement coin. Now, we've talked about LIBOR before. LIBOR is the interest rate that banks use when they lend money back and forth between them each other. Okay, this is known as a settlement. Say J.P. Morgan is short a few billion dollars in its on its books, and for the end of the day, so they call up Bank of America or Wells Fargo and say, "Hey, I need to borrow $5 billion for about 15 hours." Okay, and the LIBOR rate is what the interest rate they'll pay for that transaction. So these happen between banks all the time. What they want to do with this cryptocurrency is they want to create a cryptocurrency settlement coin that, instead of digitally sending cash back and forth between banks for settlement, they're going to send these cryptocurrencies. It's going to represent a certain amount of money that they would send. So if they were doing $5 billion transactions or whatever, maybe the settlement coins are worth $1 million piece. So they might trade, 5,000 of this settlement coin off the blockchain from one bank to the other.
Would that also be for, you know, how banks settle up with each other in like mass transactions? So because do business with, you know, whatever. And so at the end of the day, you know, with all the transactions that people have done between, you know, like I paid you a check from this bank and you gave, you know, whatever, paid your bill from this bank, and they settle up with each other and settle up usually.
No, it wouldn't do that at first, but
that's where they want to go with it.
Once they do it for interbank settlement, then they're going to sit there and go, "Hey, you know what? Why do we need cash? Why do we need the dollars? We can just use," and what they'll try to do is over time, they'll try to say, "You know what? We're not going to give you any cash anymore. We're going to get rid of it. So if you're a depositor, you're going to now have a settlement in this digital currency that we created." So that's going to be how they're going to try to bring about a digital system, get rid of the freedom of cash, and you are now forced to use bank cryptocurrencies in commerce.
And that's where, see, this is the downside of something like Bitcoin being created.
Exactly.
It's just like with any technology, you know, there's the positive side and, you know, the negative side, which usually is used by the government. And something like Bitcoin, you could see all the positives. Well, you can travel to another country and nobody knows you have all this money in Bitcoin and things like that, and you can be anonymous. But the other thing is, well, why doesn't the government, or all governments for that matter, you know, they want to go to a cashless society so they can track all your transactions and have even more control over you? Why don't they, you know, create something similar to that? And that's, you know, it kind of opened the door, even though it's a positive thing in many ways, it also opens the door for they could use it as a format to go to a cashless society. Of course, they have other formats as well. So it's not like it's if it was never created, they never would have thought of the idea. But I mean, wasn't there a city in England that did like a trial? Maybe it wasn't trial, but went like an experiment kind of, or it went cashless or something. Or
they're cashless in pretty much Norway or Denmark.
So the whole countries there are.
Yeah,
that's,
countries are.
See that
as a matter of fact, get this, they are so cashless that they brought in 800 panhandlers, homeless panhandlers, and they gave them a digital machine so that people, if they just want to donate to these homeless people, can swipe their card, their debit cards.
Yeah, it's even debit cards. You look at those, and when they first came out, oh, these are great. Like, I loved my debit card when it first came out. But then you start thinking of, okay, with debit cards, obviously it tracks every transaction, just like a credit card, but it's all your cash, and it takes away some of that freedom. Now, one of the things living in Vegas is, of course, Vegas is all cash-based stuff. You know, now, the state of Nevada isn't going to be able to stop the federal government, but they would be a state that would definitely, we would be a state that would put up a fight if they were to go cashless in the United States, because casinos are all cash-based. But yeah, I mean, it's only a matter of time until everything goes cash. I mean, a lot of people today, you know, are personally cashless for the most part. I mean, as they add, you know, like vending machines now have credit cards or debit cards you can use. It's getting to the point where almost everything is set up to, you can even take, you can fucking do it with your phone now.
Yeah. Hey, I mean, if you think about it, since 98% of all transactions now are electronic, isn't the dollar, the euro, the yen, aren't they all digital currencies anyway?
Pretty much. I mean, but you still have that option where
if you go to a bank, if you have like $100,000 in the bank, try going to a bank and asking for your money.
Oh, well, anybody who has $100,000 in a bank is a moron.
Well, that's true. Anyway, that was four major banks that were doing it. This came out late last week. A member of the European Parliament, which is who runs the EU, is proposing that €1 million be spent on a task force that would focus on studying digital currencies and blockchain technology. The push for funding comes months after the legislative arm of the European Union first approved the task force. And here's what it says. The pilot project aims at creating staffing and regulatory and technical experts in order to build up the expertise to for the proposed in the resolution of the European Parliament on virtual currencies. Now, the European Union – now, think about this. The European Union created the euro – as a means of a continental currency for all of the European, you know, for the entire continent. And that's not good enough because they've devalued that thing so that there's now negative interest rates. And now we want to trust the central bank in the European Union with a digital virtual currency, a cryptocurrency. You know what? Why don't we just shoot the bankers, go back to gold and silver? And you know what? I bet the economies would straighten out in a very short amount of time.
Well, it's just a matter of them doing that. And because of the control factor, I mean, there might be a lot of countries that are against backing currencies. Maybe not the people that are actually in, say, like, you know, parliament or whatever, but the... the people that really run a lot of things,
the bureaucrats,
may be against some of the, you know, that because of, you know, the control aspect.
Hey, remember in Star Wars, the first movie with the young Anakin, and Queen Amidala was trying to get her Senate representative to call for the Republic to go save her planet, and the Senate Palpatine, who ended up being, of course, the Sith Lord Emperor, but Palpatine says the Chancellor has no real power. He's run by the bureaucrats. And you see him up there, and he's got those two dudes sitting behind him on that floating podium. And the question was posed to him, and the bureaucrats whispered in his ear, and he backed down. That's exactly the way the European Union is, because the whole parliament is run by unelected officials who know nothing and just are out there for their own self-interest. By the way, speaking of central banks – Japan, I think I mentioned a month or so ago, Japan is doing a run on their banks so much that their people are buying out all the safes.
Yeah, I know Japan, Germany.
Germany is now doing it.
Isn't Italy having some serious problems?
Well, Italy has banking problems, but their people are already screwed because they've been under austerity for the last 8 years. So if anybody has any money... hopefully they don't have any banks. But here's an interesting thing. Switzerland, the banking center of the world, right? They've got negative interest rates, and they're starting to impose fees on depositors in their banks.
Yeah, and they're getting insurance on them. Right? I know you had mentioned, why don't they just buy gold?
Exactly. Now, here's the thing. Get this. You've got your money in a bank and a deposit. The bank, because they're getting negative interest rates when they borrow money from the central bank, so they're charging you to hold your money.
I don't get that. I mean, I get why they're doing it, but I don't get why people are keeping their fucking money in a bank.
Because it's the same. Because how many people? Say you're a business, and you've got 5 million euros in your business. Are you going to walk around?
Well, you buy
in a house.
You buy a bunch of gold, and you get a huge safe.
You need to do payroll. You need the liquidity.
You
got to
get a safe,
system.
Man.
But what I'm just saying is, if you've run a business before, you have to have the liquidity to do payroll to pay invoices.
Oh, okay. You're talking about businesses.
Yeah, you can't walk back and forth in cash, gold, and silver every day.
Well, right. If it's a business. It's hard not to, you gotta find a way to become a cash fucking business, man. Exactly. In all seriousness, there are cash businesses.
But say if you're a Coca-Cola bottler, that's not a major corporate. But that's something that's going to make...
It depends how big you are, obviously. If you're a huge corporation, it's not going to work. But if you have a small business, you go cash, and maybe you even go to the point where you don't accept credit cards. Or if you do, you clean out the fucking account every, day or every couple days.
Individuals.
That's really what I'm talking about. Right now, why do you have your money in a bank if you're an individual?
Any dime that I don't need. See, when I get my income, I pay my bills. I keep about $100, maybe $110 in there. Everything else I take out and I put it in gold and silver. The $110 is if I need to use my debit card somewhere. Otherwise, I spend, I just keep the cash outside the bank.
Yeah, that's what you got to do. There's no...
And if I've got too much of the cash, like I said, it goes into gold and silver. And I just keep a certain amount of cash out of the bank, just in case there's bank holiday, the ATMs don't work.
Well, the whole point, the whole reason why people kept savings, you keep money in there to pay your bills, and that's really all you need. But the reason people kept savings in a bank, one, they felt it was safe, if somebody tried to rob me or my house or whatever, but then you can go to get a safety deposit box somewhere. But they kept it in banks because they would get interest, but you don't anymore.
But after 2008 and in 2010,
right, you haven't got any interest.
It's not just that. Your deposits are considered unfunded liabilities to the bank. It's a liability. It's not an asset to the bank. The bank, when you give your money to the bank or get your direct deposit to the bank, it's a liability to the bank. Okay? You're a bondholder now. You're not a depositor. You're a bondholder.
So why would they even have savings accounts?
Well, that's the question, because people are lazy.
No, but I mean, if you're a bank, why have savings accounts?
Why? Because they want to sucker people into keeping their money there, because then they can leverage.
All right, they have more money in the bank, obviously.
100 to 1, right. and borrow from the Fed.
Right, right.
Yeah, because it's an asset that they can leverage. You know, when a corporation sells a bond, a corporate bond, they get cash for that. Okay, it's the same thing with you. You may have access to your money, but your money's not there. You go to a bank and try to get, you know, $50,000 out, they'll tell you come back in a week, because they got to contact the Fed to print up some new bills so they can pay you back. They don't have the money in there. You know, they do, but it's not something that they can do very often, you know. Bank robbers would be robbing banks if they didn't have cash there. But now in Switzerland, companies know that they're going to get, you know, 70, say, for every million euros they have in there, they're going to get $7,500 or 7,500 euros or francs taken out per year. So they're paying 1,000 francs to insure every million francs that they have. So they're not only, you know, it's so strange, because instead of just taking out and not getting the 7,500 franc, fee put on there for every million francs they have in their Swiss francs, they're paying 1,000 Swiss francs just to insure it, so that when they get that money taken from them, the insurance company will pay them, you know, you're insuring money. It's insane. The whole system is insane, you know.
Well, what do you expect from a, you know, government
from 50 years of Keynesianism? We don't have capitalism. We have creditism. And once you get down...
Well, it's an oligarchy as well, so...
Yeah, once you get down the past so long, it's impossible. You can't pay it off. So you have to keep printing up new as the stuff rolls over, or it collapses. You know, the new data just came out for the U.S. national debt. $19.5 trillion is what the national debt is, and before Obama leaves in January, it should be over the 20 trillion mark.
Yeah, and they don't care. It will continue to go up and up, and I don't know. I mean, pretty much we're all just fucked, in my opinion.
By the way,
so many ways, but
you know the old saying about gold and silver: if you don't hold it, you don't own it.
Yeah, I know somebody didn't deliver. That was in Germany.
Yep, Deutsche Bank. See, they have an ETF called Xetra Gold. It's similar to the gold ETF GLD here in the States on our markets. Now, what it is an ETF is when people buy paper shares in the ETF with the promise that an underwriter bank, for the GLD, it's JP Morgan, for Xetra Gold, it's Deutsche Bank, that these banks have the gold commensurate with each share that's sold. Physical gold is in their vaults. And according to Xetra Gold, as opposed to the GLD, if somebody wants to demand delivery, they can do it. Well, a large third party decided that they wanted delivery. So Xetra went over to Deutsche Bank, said, hey, we need the gold. And Deutsche Bank said, we don't have the gold.
Right. And didn't they say, well, we'll give you the money and then you can go buy some gold with it?
Exactly. Their response was,
that's pretty fucked up.
Sell your shares and you can take your cash and go buy coins at your coin dealer.
Right.
No, my contract here says that you'll deliver. Where's the gold, jackasses?
So what did they end up doing? Just paying them out what it was worth?
I don't know. It's still ongoing, but they're in they're in scapegoat mode.
Because really what they need to do is go and buy the gold themselves and then deliver it. They would need to buy it from somebody else is what they should do.
Well, they should.
I mean, it's fucked up in the first place that they're selling shit that they don't have. But
you can try to do a lawsuit to force them to do it. But, you know, that thing's going to be in the government courts for years, so it's moot.
Yeah, but what they can do is, you know, destroy their reputation.
Deutsche Bank is already, who cares?
Destroyed.
You know, Deutsche Bank is insolvent, so they're screwed anyway.
So I guess it doesn't matter. Well, that's why if I buy gold, I make sure I have it. So
if you don't own it, if you don't hold it, you don't own it.
Yeah, you gotta hold on to your.
And I wrote an article just before the show. One of the big things that is coming up is there's certain investment firms that are trying to sell you gold IRAs. You know, you can sell your 401ks and your IRAs. And instead of not having to pay the tax or the early release fee, you can transfer it directly over into a physical gold IRA. Well, one of the things they've been telling people is that you can actually take the gold home with you. The IRS came out with a report said, no, you can do that only in certain instances. And for all those people who've been taking their gold home, we're watching you. And so I think that one, that's going to fall by the wayside. The way you can do it where you can take it home, and the way that the investment firms have been telling people, is that you have to have a place where you can segregate your gold and silver, your IRA, away from all the rest of your wealth and money. You know, it has to be separate, like a safe that has only your IRA gold. You can't put other things in the safe with it. It has to be segregated. Well, that only works if you have your IRA through an LLC. If your IRA is an individual under your name, you can't do it. You've got to have it stored in a safety deposit box somewhere else, outside your hands.
Yeah, and that's not good. But that's about all the time we have left for tonight. So I'd like to thank Ken, as always. Go check him out at The Daily Economist and on his new channel on YouTube, Ken Schortgen. Search, type in Ken Schortgen.
Or The Daily. You can search The Daily Economist. Daily Economist. And more often than not, it'll show up.
Yeah. Well, it shows up when you search Ken Schortgen, too.
Yep.
You could see the channel will pop up, and then you just click on the channel name, and it will bring you to all the videos. So, so definitely check that out, and tune in to Ken's new podcast on YouTube. So, thanks to Ken as always, and we will be back tomorrow with nobody, but we'll be back with me, and we'll be talking about crazy sports parents, actually, and it gives me the opportunity to talk a little more about parenting, as we have so much on this show. So I'll be back tomorrow. So thanks, everybody, for tuning in. And again, thanks to Ken, thedailyeconomist.com. And again, Ken Schortgen on YouTube. Thanks, everybody.